Hello, everyone. Today is June 13, 2023. It's a couple of minutes after 3 p.m. This is a City of Prescott City Council voting meeting. Mayor Pro Tem, do we have any announcements or introductions?
Got to get used to the button. We do have, I guess I see one introduction out there as our superintendent from PUSD, Joe Howard. So I'll just say hi, Joe. All right, on to announcements. And if I missed anyone, I'm sorry. Let's see anyone else. First, monsoon season is almost here. Here are a few tips for you to prepare for monsoon season, courtesy of KCDO with Water Resources Department in Public Works. Prepare an emergency kit. During monsoon season, rain, lightning, and thunderstorms pose a higher possibility of losing electricity for a few hours. Be prepared for this situation by building your own emergency kit. Pack up some flashlights with extra batteries, candles, and matches, and a battery-powered radio. The Arizona Department of Emergency and Military Affairs also recommends keeping a disaster relief kit on hand with food, water containers, and other items such as a can opener or a dust mask. Don't drive through standing water. It's better to be safe than sorry. Don't risk going through the flooded bridge because you think you can make it. Drive the long way around to avoid a flooded street and pull off to the side of the road. Stay safe and avoid flooded roadways during monsoon season and all year long. Prepare plants and trees for monsoon. Heavy winds and flooding are common during monsoon season, so take the time to protect plants and trees that you tend to all year. Trim any tree branches that can break off, causing damage, and secure any new plants or trees that may become uprooted with heavy winds. Tidy and secure your yard. When it comes to wind and rain, it's also important to keep the items important to you safe. Remember to secure your yard furniture and clean up any clothing or toys you may have lying around. Outdoor equipment such as tools and shovels should be safely stowed in a shed or a garage. I need to tell my son that. You don't want the wind to make that piece of equipment or toy turn into a dangerous flying object. And next announcement. A few weeks ago, I attended the farmers market and met with dozens of citizens about city matters. It was great connecting with everyone in person, and I plan to do more. I'm continuing my public outreach. Be sure to check out the city's Facebook page for more details of the next upcoming events. I hope to see you soon. Finally, I'll also be continuing office hours at the Prescott Public Library on Tuesday, June 20th from 3 to 5. I also hope to see you there as well.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. We'll now have an invocation from Pastor Rich Stofan from the Pine Rock Congregation, followed by a Pledge of Allegiance by Councilman Moore.
Thank you, Mayor. Father God, we thank you for a beautiful day today. We thank you for your presence, not just in our lives, but in this place. We pray that you would be present in each one of the discussions, that each person would be able to speak in the way that they need to, and that calm would prevail, and that you would be with our councilmen and councilwomen, and you would give them wisdom and courage. And thank you for the good job that they do. It's a beautiful thing to live in Prescott. We thank you for this community. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Good.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Montoya.
Here.
Councilwoman Cantelmi.
Here.
Councilman Moore.
Here.
Councilmember Rusing.
Here.
Councilman Sishka.
Here.
And Councilman Tenney.
Yes, ma'am.
All are present.
Very good. We'll now move on to our presentations. City Manager.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Our first presentation is the annual presentation from APS regarding fire mitigation and summer readiness. And I believe we have Frank Sanderson of APS here. He's the Northwest Division Director.
Good to see you again, Frank.
Hey, good seeing you. It's been great getting to be part of this community. Honorable Mayor and esteemed Council, it is my pleasure to be here with you. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Frank Sanderson. I'm the Northern Division Director. Many of you know Mackenzie Rogers, who was previously in this spot. She has moved on to head up our statewide transmission. And so I'll be trying to fill those shoes. And so I'd appreciate patience with me as I try to do that. On the screens, you'll see a flyer that we put out with many of the points that I'm going to cover today. They are on the table in the back if anybody would like one. APS, some of our foundational principles, I would say safety is a value, not necessarily a priority, and reliability is a priority. When we think about those two things, we really want to make sure that our communities, our customers, and our partners are safe. Especially, you know, we talked a little bit about monsoon season, also fire season is upon us. Just a couple of stats to get the conversation going. In 2022, there were 1,248 fires that burned over 145,000 acres. 433 of those were caused by lightning. So far this year, we've had 469 fires, and this was as of this morning. Human caused were 293 of those were human caused, 23 were lightning caused, and 153 unknown. And that has currently burned 15,639 acres statewide. Our approach at APS to fire mitigation is one of prevention, mitigation, and response. When we talk about prevention, we start out many months ago doing patrols on over 1,900 miles of overhead line, and that's both from a vegetation management perspective and from our overall infrastructure perspective. And so we've employed a lot of newer technologies, and such as drones, flights, and different things like that. And then we also do the good old-fashioned walk in the line. And so a lot of work has gone into making sure our infrastructure is robust and that vegetation is in a state to where it will mitigate or lessen the likelihood of ignitions around our equipment, which protects the community. Just like the FireWise community, understanding, you know, where vegetation is, the different things we put around, you know, things that are important to us. We practice a mode of mitigation called DSAP, and that's defensible space around poles. We also do that around our substations. We've seen in the years past as we've done that, that as fires go through, the likelihood of the destruction of that infrastructure or, you know, substations, it tends to go around it. So that's been very successful. We also have a program that's available on our website for those, you know, members of the community that may be interested. And it's much around the FireWise platform that, you know, it's a right tree, right place. Having just barely moved to the Prescott area, there's a lot of trees around my house, and you start thinking about that, and I'm just renting right now, so I can't necessarily cut down his trees, but it does kind of make me think about, you know, what the best plan of attack in maintaining, you know, property. So as far as mitigation goes, we change our protocols as we move into different fire response levels. Currently in this area in Prescott, we're in what's called a P2 level. Once we move into P3, and that's based on, you know, several factors between, you know, what kind of moisture we've received, the wind, the heat, the fuels, all those different things, we change into a different response mode. And, you know, we really want to make the community aware of it, because what happens is if a line goes out for whatever reason, lightning, foreign interference, we do not re-energize like we normally do when we're in the P3 response mode, because what we want to do, again, safety over reliability, we want to make sure that before we turn those lights back on, that we don't have something on that line that could cause a spark, that could cause a fire, and endanger our communities. And so, just like was said in what I'll call the safety moment or the talking about monsoon season. It's really important for community members to know that if you have an outage, you can report that by phone or through our app. And you can also get updates on where the outages are, what the estimated restoration times are. And as you can imagine, as we go out to some of these areas, it's long lines, like, again, 1,900 miles of line, and it's in some really treacherous terrain. And so a lot of times they're doing this at night, you know, trying to get equipment and different things out. So it's important to have that safety kit, that storm kit, where you have food, where you have lights, candles. And the other important thing I really want to touch on is, you know, when your power is out, we all have food, we have refrigerators. It's important to keep those closed. If you keep them closed, it really maintains, you know, perishable foods for a longer period of time. We've done some enhancements over the last year, and I'm sure Mackenzie last year talked about some of the efforts from the year before, but we're installing more devices. We've installed over 2,500 fault indicators, and it's almost like Christmas tree lights, if you will. And what those do is when we have an outage and we're trying to understand where the fault is and whether we can turn the lights back on, they're hung on the line and they can detect the fault and they light up. And so as our troublemen go to patrol those lines, it leads them directly to, you know, and it still may be miles, but it gives them a better idea of where the fault is. And so this summer you may be driving down the road and see, you know, blinking lights on the power lines, and that's what those are. Those are indicators to help us more quickly understand where the defect is and restore power. We've also put in a lot of what we call smart devices that limit the size of the outage and gives us some remote telemetry and ability to operate the system remotely. We continue to partner with all of our emergency management services. I think APS had a record 32 of our employees attended the Wildfire Academy held at Emory Riddle. We're really trying to be good partners there. They have a very important job to do, and we don't want to be in their way, but we want to be a partner with them. And so we built some really good relationships there. We have journeymen that are on call 24/7 to respond, to make those outages as short as we possibly can. And then we also just want to remind our community members that if you see a line down, assume that it's energized. Never think that it's de-energized. Call 911 through either the app or the phone. Call APS, let us know, and we will get resources there to respond. And with that, we feel like we are prepared for this season. We did get some snow, more than usual, which is a blessing, and some precipitation a month or so ago, but the fuels are there. And again, with having, you know, hundreds, 469 fires already this year, we are prepared and ready to go, and we're here to support. So with that, I'll open it up to questions.
Thank you, Frank. What would a normal year be for the number of fires at this time of the calendar?
So it's hard to say because it varies. It all depends on the moisture that you get during the winter season. And so last year, what I can tell you, I haven't looked at all the data, but what I can tell you is last year at this time, we were already in P3. So we were already, you know, in that heightened response mode. And so it has been a blessing that we're not there yet. And from all indicators, it'll probably be a couple more weeks before we get into that. And hopefully, you know, we're keeping our fingers crossed that those monsoon rains come, hopefully with not very much wind. And I can get you some more statistics on that if you'd like.
Yeah, they have a tendency to go together, don't they?
Yeah.
Do you have any questions or comments? Councilmember Rusing?
Thank you, and welcome, Frank.
Thank you.
I just wanted to thank you and APS for investing in the infrastructure to make your system more reliable. We've had some tremendous winds this winter, horizontal snow, and my electricity has been much more reliable than it was, like, say, 30 years ago when every time the wind blew, the power went out. Thank you.
Well, it's our pleasure, and we're not perfect. We are trying to make it as resilient as we possibly can.
No? Well, thank you very much, Frank, and we'll look forward to a calm season. How about that? Thank you. City Manager?
Thank you. Yes, up next is the an item that I believe was brought forward by Councilmember Tenney and Councilmember Montoya, if I'm correct.
Correct.
This is the Billions to Gain campaign, and I think we have Laura Rosensweet. Did I say it right? Rosensweet? Or, okay. And Laura is the Community Outreach Manager for Education Forward Arizona.
Very short person following a very tall person. thank you very much for this invitation, Mayor and Council members. Really appreciate the opportunity to speak to you today. So my name is Laura Rosensweet, and I'm from Education Forward Arizona. We're a statewide, nonprofit, nonpartisan organization working to promote the value of education for all Arizonans. What I'm going to talk to you about today is our new economic impact report and how Arizona has everything to gain when individuals pursue additional education and training after high school, whether that's immediately after high school or whether they return to education and training down their career path. Before I talk about that, I did want to mention just a couple of points from the past, as I know that in the past, this council may have been different than it is now. So back in 2016, our organization had a couple of different names, and one of the names was Achieve 60. So some of you may be familiar with that organization. And what Achieve 60 was they set a statewide goal around attainment using workforce data and the needs of the state to say by the year 2030, we would like to see 60% of working age Arizonans hold some sort of degree, credential, or industry licensure. And right now we're at 48%, just to give you some context. So that is really what drives all of the work that our organization does, is we're helping the state meet that goal of 60% attainment, is what we call it, by the year 2030. And when I talk about When I talk about attainment, I want to just stress that attainment involves education and training opportunities for individuals after high school. So that's not just two-year and four-year degrees, but all of our different trade schools, military opportunities, apprenticeships, anything that leads to a licensure, industry credential, or certificate are also encompassed within what we call attainment. And the last thing I want to mention before we talk about the actual report is back in 2016 as well, an organization which is now part of us was called Expect More Arizona. And we worked really hard to build what's called the Arizona Education Progress Meter. And the city of Prescott, the reason I have that little highlighted part of the slide, is the city of Prescott was an endorser of the Arizona Education Progress Meter. And so what that meant was the city said, yes, we believe in these goals that have been set around education. So on our website and also on the handout you have in front of you, you can see there's 8 indicators that lead up to that attainment number. And if you go on the website, you can drill down into any of those to look at your city or community or even down into your school district data to see things like how are we doing on third grade reading and eighth grade math, so on and so forth. So that was part of back in 2016 when the state set that overall goal of how do we want to meet workforce needs and provide Arizonans with opportunities for additional education and training. So what I'm here to talk about really today, that was just a mini background, is back in March, so a couple months ago, Education Forward Arizona and Helios Education Foundation co-released a report looking at economic impact of education and training after high school. And just to give you context, who the report was built around was the graduating high school class of 2022, which is about 70,000 Arizona public high school students. And so they used them as the cohort to build build this report. I'm not going to go into a ton of detail about the numbers simply because of time, but on one of the handouts you have in front of you, it gives you all of the numbers as far as the individual earning potential based around how much education and training you have after high school. So in this report, what we looked at was individual earning potential, social benefits for communities in the state, and fiscal benefits for communities in the state. So I'm just going to talk about each of those just briefly. So as you see additional education and training opportunities, and Arizonans taking advantage of that, of course, it's probably not a surprise that they have higher lifetime earnings and increased access to different job opportunities and additional job security if there's any shifts in the economy or they have to move or something changes for them. So that's what we looked at for individual earning potential. Now, one of the areas that people don't always associate with economic impact is the social gains. So in our report, which is titled Billions to Gain, the reason that it has that name is when we looked at the social factors that go into healthy communities, and I'm just gonna list out a few of them, for example. So as individuals pursue additional education and training, you're gonna see increased health outcomes, which is not typically related, you know, directly to education in many people's minds. We see reduction in crime. We see reduction in reliance on social programs, things like social services, social health care, food programs. And so those social benefits to the state is where the billions of dollars comes in. And you can see, once again, some of those numbers on the handout. I didn't put them up on the screen just for time's sake. And then the last part of the report are the fiscal benefits. Fiscal is a little bit more straightforward. It's higher tax revenues and lower public expenditures. And those numbers are also in the billions. So when you look at the report on the handout that you have, there's a couple of different lines there, but what they studied was, if we had an increase of 10% in college completion, or an increase in 20% in college enrollment, and the impact on the Arizona economy. So it's literally billions of dollars for the state and millions of dollars for individual communities. A lot of times people will say, well, what can we do as a city? Does this really relate to us? So I wanted to just highlight a couple of things that we pulled out of the report. So there are opportunities for cities to engage with additional education and training opportunities, which I have up on the screen there. But the really cool thing is that when I looked at the city of Prescott strategic plan, you already have a lot of great items going, and so I wanted to highlight that. Before I leave this slide, I'll just go over a couple of them. So dual enrollment, you have a lot of great opportunities for dual enrollment within the city. I know the high schools have worked really hard to provide those options. Helping students complete the FAFSA, once again, there's some really great work going on there, and a lot of other things. The last thing just to end on here is the City of Prescott strategic plan for this year. I just pulled out goal number 2, which mentions education specifically, and the strategy there, which is excellent to increase opportunities for education and training. You know, they talk about partnership with the K-12 community, which seems to be really strong in this community. And then just providing all sorts of opportunities for both students leaving high school and students returning to education and training opportunities. So finally, what we're out doing in the state right now is just talking about the fact that Arizona has everything to gain. That's kind of our slogan right now, when individuals pursue additional training and education after high school. And with that, I will take any questions or comments from the group.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to say, I think this is a great program. I think that the you coming to this presentation is great. And it's funny to me that you mentioned about the dual enrollment program that the schools run here. I was talking to my daughter, and she's actually only taking one high school class next year as a junior, and the rest of them are going to be either college classes or AP classes. So I do think it's the message and the partnership we have with PUSD is pretty strong.
Absolutely. Gives her that jump start for whatever she wants to pursue after high school.
Any other questions or concerns from the council?
Yeah. I really appreciate
Thank
the presentation
you,
as well.
Councilman Tenney.
Thank you, Mayor. Conceptually, I think we can get our minds around we're all going to do better economically if more people go to college, complete college, et cetera. But to see data estimates related to that is powerful. It's impactful. And it lets us know that we probably can and should be doing more as individuals and communities to encourage education in general, and particularly tertiary education. So thank you so much for the presentation.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Councilwoman Cantelmi.
very much. I appreciate that, Mayor. You know, this is a wonderful opportunity, and I have to just point out something that everybody knows that lives here. We, as a small community, I can't even tell you, begin to tell you the support we have throughout the whole community for all these items. And I wanted to kind of make a shout out for Ollie also. We have continuing education for older people.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's a great one. And the mentorship that I have seen over the years, too, just in the community of, you know, the reaching down and building these kids up. It's such a great organization. So we do have a leg up, I would say, than like Maricopa County or some of the bigger communities. It's been solid here, and I think Grant can attest to that. Not Grant.
You probably met me, and I definitely can attest to that. Thanks.
I was looking at these name tags and thinking,
I don't know what I had on my mind. Yeah. No kidding, but thank you very much.
Kind of catchy there, Grant Tenney.
Clark, it's such a great name.
Well, thank you very much, Laura. We appreciate your presentation, and we certainly support effective quality education in our district and charter schools, for that matter, and post-high school education is something that I think all students want to make sure that they understand their obligations as a citizen, and then being able to be independent and self-sustaining. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
So that concludes our presentations, and we'll move to the open call to the public.
Thanks, Mayor. The City of Prescott welcomes public engagement. Residents may comment and address the council regarding matters that are not included on the posted agenda during the call to the public. If you wish to speak, please complete a green speaker card and submit it to me prior to the meeting being convened. As a reminder, speakers are limited to 4 minutes, and the call to the public will be limited to 40 minutes in total, with the following stipulations. Citizens are limited to addressing council on the same topic only 4 times in total. If a topic has been addressed more than 5 times by different speakers, the mayor may limit further discussion on this topic, and topics of a primary national concern may be limited to the discretion of the mayor. I do have 4 speaker cards, Mayor, and the first one up is Ralph Hess.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. I am Ralph Hess. I'm a resident and citizen of the City of Prescott. Recently, officials from the Prescott Frontier Days have expressed eagerness to renegotiate the new terms for the lease between Prescott Frontier Days and the City of Prescott, related to the rodeo grounds and the use of the rodeo grounds. I'm here to present a petition in accordance with the city charter seeking to set a public comment period of 60 days and 2 public hearings during that comment period. Earlier today, you heard some issues or some questions regarding what is a citizen's petition under the charter look like? This is what it looks like. The city practice of posting the agenda on Thursday for voting on those issues on this subsequent Tuesday allow 5 days for citizens to consider agenda items, determine whether they're going to make a comment, create a comment, and then deliver a comment for 3 minutes immediately before you vote on the item. And what I'm saying is that practice for actively engaged citizens, which I think is a necessary component of democratic republic form of government, need more time to do that and get to have you not only or not have them not only be able to give you a meaningful comment, but for you to consider exactly what that comment is before you make a decision that you have to make in a subsequent vote. So that brings me to my petition. This is a petition for the Prescott City Council, Prescott, Arizona, to adopt a resolution regarding any consideration of a lease regarding city-owned realty known as Yavapai County Fairgrounds or Prescott Rodeo Grounds. In accordance with City of Prescott Charter, Article 2, Section 18, I, the undersigned citizen of the City of Prescott, County of Yavapai, State of Arizona, respectfully petition the Prescott City Council to consider, approve, and adopt in accordance with City of Prescott Charter, Article 7, the attached proposed resolution regarding any consideration of a lease regarding the city-owned realty known as Yavapai County Fairgrounds or Prescott Rodeo Grounds. Petitioner is not opposed to the City Council modifying the proposed resolution. As long as the proposed provision in Section 5 regarding the 60-day public comment period and public hearings is not substantially modified. And I'm not going to read the whole resolution to you, but because of time restraints, but I will read that Section 5. Section 5, that prior to voting upon any lease of the city-owned realty known as Yavapai County Fairgrounds or Prescott Rodeo Grounds, the city shall require a public comment period of no less than 60 days following the first City Council public meeting discussion to consider such lease. And during such comment period, the city shall conduct two duly noticed public meetings. And I wouldn't mind if you have more than two public meetings.
Please conclude your remarks, Mr. Hess. Right.
I have personally signed this petition with my first and last name. I am a citizen and qualified elector of the State of Arizona, County of Yavapai, City of Prescott. The petition is further supported by the attached list of signatories incorporated by this reference. And I have petitions of almost 200 individuals who have signed in support of this petition. The one last suggestion I have is, because you have to make a decision, act upon this, by July 11th, your meeting, voting meeting of July 11th, I also encourage you to have a study session on this on the June 27th meeting, so that if there's any tweaking that can be done, we can.
Thank you, Mr. Hess. I believe you can present that petition to the city clerk.
Thank you.
Marty Siegel.
Good afternoon, members of the council. My name is Marty Siegel. I live at 810 Norris Road in a beautiful log home that my parents had built on property that was purchased from Fred Schimmer back in 1956. My home is about 0.3 tenths of a mile directly south of the rodeo and fairgrounds. I'm a resident of Prescott. I grew up in town. I was a member of the very first grade class at Sacred Heart Grade School. And yes, I am a Neanderthal, a 1968 graduate of Prescott High School. In accordance with the City of Prescott's Charter, Article 2, Section 18, I'm here today to respectfully petition that the Prescott City Council consider, approve, and adopt a resolution that would require a public comment period of no less than 60 days, with three duly noticed public hearings conducted by the city during that comment period. Prior to the city council voting on any application regarding current zoning conditions, rezoning, or approval of a master plan, conceptual plan, or site plan of the city-owned property known as the Yavapai County Fairgrounds or Prescott Rodeo Grounds. In addition to my own signature, I am submitting petitions with 175 other citizen signatures who are also in support of this resolution. The rodeo grounds have long been a source of enjoyment and pride and history for our community. I live in the neighborhood, and I fondly recall as a girl walking through my backyard, through Fred Schimmer's corral, and right down to the rodeo grounds where I could browse through exhibits at the Yavapai County Fair in the historic Freeman Building. I delighted in having all of my high school and middle school girlfriends and an occasional boyfriend come over to my house so that we could walk down to the rodeo grounds from my quiet neighborhood. Now my grandchildren who come to visit me get to experience some of the joys that I had when I was a little girl. And yet I still recall many people who were trespassing through my property during big events over at the fairgrounds and the rodeo grounds because they too were seeking access to the grounds from Norris Road. I know firsthand about increased traffic flow, even on my gorgeous dead-end street during big events at the grounds. And because my home is so close to the rodeo and the fairgrounds, I really hear those loudspeakers from the 7:30 a.m. singing of the Star-Spangled Banner right up until the closing comments of the announcers bidding everyone a safe farewell home. So, while the refurbishment of our existing facilities is probably long overdue and does not appear to be controversial, the Prescott Frontier Days proposed expansion with additional facilities and events has generated many very strong opinions. And unfortunately, the public transparency shown thus far by the Prescott Frontier Days has been sadly inadequate. So I, along with 175 other signatures of these petitions, therefore am asking the City Council
Marty, to please conclude your remarks. Thank
the
you.
The transparency required before making such a major decision about this property, a decision that will irrevocably change the neighborhoods and, dare I say, the western side of town. And so, while not requested here, we also support an idea suggested by some of you that before any voting is done on the master plan or such plan, referral would
please conclude your remarks, Marty.
The Prescott residents for such facilities be expanded. I thank you in advance for your future consideration and your tolerance of my extra time at the microphone.
Thank you.
Larry Nelson.
Hi, all. I'll step back here so I can use my time up. Does your time remaining thing work? I'm gonna be brief. So we're with the Granite Creek Mural Project. I know all of you and everybody's been very supportive. Joe's gone, but Joe Bain has been very supportive. But something happened last week, and I asked an elected official how to go about getting something done, and the comment kind of shocked me. And that's not even important, because what it did is told me we need to take the time to do more PR to the council. And so, anyway. So I think that I just want to remind you real briefly, this is what we started with. Maybe show the audience too. So we're trying to turn what looks kind of like a ghetto into something that people will be proud to come down and see. And we do everything we can by ourselves. We wouldn't come here if we thought we could do something ourselves. We just figure out a way to get it done. When we're done with this mural, the value will be, it'll be a $100,000 mural that we are producing and giving to the community. Everything's going well. We're right on track. If you haven't been down there for a while, this actually was a week ago. And it's We're way beyond that now. So we're on track. We're trying to keep that area pristine, but we need a little extra support. So I pick up the dog poop every day. I pick up the trash every day. We keep the whole area of the trail clean, but I have a couple requests, and some of them are urgent, and that's why I'm here too. So tree fell down over the trail, and a contractor came and took the firewood away, but they left this huge mess that people have to walk by. And I don't have a pickup truck. I could rent something, but maybe the city could ask to make this a little priority, especially before the next events. I don't like to take people down there when the garbage can is, I mean, you can't even touch the thing. So we have a few requests, but I'm going to go through this. And so we get hundreds of visitors every day. It's becoming a destination. I want to show you some of the visitors that, well, I've got it. Yes. This is really uncomfortable, in case you don't know. It's my issue, though. So there's a typical day. 20 mothers pushing strollers and their little kids. The leader of that group said, we wouldn't have come down here a year ago. We would have been scared to death. And here's one that I know some of you have seen. But this one, so this is a mother, a young mother, bent down, little kid with his hand on her shoulder. They're watching him paint the mural. That wouldn't have happened a year ago. We're doing what we can. You know, we're a small group of retirees. You know, some of us have been working 7 days a week, and we're devoting our whole summer to this. We won't have a day off till November. And we're retired people. That's valuable time for us. As some of you may know, we've logged thousands of volunteer hours. We're going to log thousands more. We've spent thousands of dollars of our own money. We're doing what we can to make this happen. What I can't do is get rid of that stupid brush pile. So maybe you could help with that. Graffiti. We don't bother anybody. We just take care of it. Rah. So our ask, haul off the debris before the Bluegrass Festival and before the rodeo. We're going to bring thousands of people through there. People
Please conclude your remarks, Larry.
Am I out of time?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so two things. We would like two garbage cans, and please don't tell me again that we don't have anybody to empty it. I will empty it. Just put the thing out there. We don't need anything fancy. We can use the 55-gallon drums with the lid on it, just standard like all the other places. That's one.
Please conclude your remarks.
Two benches as well, because people go and eat their lunch down there now. You have several benches that people won't even sit on if you look at where they're positioned. So we have unused benches. We would like to borrow a couple of those for the summer.
Larry, your time's up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Send us an email.
Steven Sidlovsky.
Really? I can forward you the one I already sent, but you didn't get it. Thank you for your support. Hey, come down and visit us at the mural. It's pretty cool.
Beloved Mayor and City Council, I'm Lay Brother Stephen Gerard, and I've got a stopwatch, so I know my time.
You know, I think, Stephen, you've exceeded your opportunity to address the council. I think we've made that very clear.
This is an invitation, actually, if I may.
You've exceeded your opportunity to address the council.
Should I stay here and be silent for 4 minutes, Mayor?
No, you're no longer allowed to address the council because you've exceeded your time to address the issue.
It's an invitation not really related to
I'm sorry, but you've exceeded your opportunity to address the council. You have no opportunity to address the council now or in the future.
That sounds unconstitutional.
I think we've made that very clear to you. Thank you.
That's all we have, Mayor.
We'll now move on to our consent agenda. Does any member of the council want to pull any items for discussion? Councilwoman can't tell me? No? I'd like to pull item H.
Mayor, I'll make a motion.
Well, go ahead.
Okay. I just want to make sure you recognize me first. Mayor, I move to approve consent agenda items A through I, excluding H.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion?
I'm sorry, who made the second?
Councilman Moore.
Thank you, Councilman Moore.
All right, we'll take a vote. All in favor, please indicate yes.
Sarah, I'm a yes.
I'm also a yes.
I'm also a yes.
I'm a yes also.
I'm a yes. Do we have any nays here?
We do not. That passes 7-0.
Very good.
Okay, Mayor, I believe we have Mark Woodfill here who can speak to it if you have any questions for him.
Okay, item 8H is updating the city's pension funding. And with the packet we have a projected unfunded liability of $8.6 million. So I know that we've expired our Prop 443 tax, and I understand that some of this liability number is based upon a smoothing option that's provided by PSPRS. But I want to make sure that we're very clear on where we stand and what obligations we're going to have moving forward over the next fiscal year.
As far as where the pension, I'm sorry, Mayor. Thank you, Mark Woodfill, Budget and Finance Director, for those of you who don't know me. Where we stand with the pension liability as of today, is that the question, Mayor?
Well, that's true. I mean, I'm looking at page 114 in our packet with an unfunded pension liability total of $8.675 million and a funding ratio of 94.3%.
Yes, sir. And I can address that. As you said, we did stop the tax. The tax is still dribbling in, even though it stopped. There's old returns being filed. Where do we stand today is an excellent question, and one I would be afraid to give you an answer to, because of course, as we know, these are actuarial valuations which change constantly with missed earnings rates, which we've seen the last year and we'll see again this year. I have no doubt, hopefully it will not be negative this year like it was last year. But just to go through real quick, yes, the current liability is 8675049, which is in your packet. If we go the right way with my little thing. If you'll remember back on January 10th when we got the lax actuarial, and in January 10th of 2024 when we get the, it'll be a little earlier than that in December, but when we get the new actuarial, we'll be a lot better able to tell you where we stand with all the activity that's happened. This doesn't respond very well. There's the amount by the individual different funds that we talked about. We talked about why we were here because of all the additional contributions council has made and council has decided to make, as well as the Prop 443 number 60. At that point in time, it was about $66 million. Since then, we've brought in close to $9 million this year, which if you just did math, you'd say we're fully funded. But we're not going to be, because the earnings rates over the last 2 years are going to affect that as we get the actuarial report, which is something we want to talk about as we get into the strategic planning process for the next budget year. We want to talk about a possible establishment of a reserve requirement to take to take care of these fluctuations that we will see in pension funding as Tier 1 and Tier 2 pension liabilities play out over the next 50 to 60 years. We need to be able to address those issues so we don't get into in the case like we were. And again, as we talked about in January, and just think it's worth saying, as we move forward, we're having fewer enrollments in Tier 1 and Tier 2, and Tier 3 is going up. At the current time, we have four inactive vested, but 33 individuals in that Tier 3, which is a much more sound plan for various reasons. And again, you can see what has happened to our pension cost rate as we go through. But through the, as we mentioned, through the strategic planning process, we'll be looking at how council wants to set up that reserve and what that reserve would look like. Did that answer all your questions?
Well, I know that PSPRS's actual rate of return this year was -4% against a 7.3% expected rate of return.
So that was in 22. And here is their actual rate of return, the reported rate. As you can see, it fluctuates a little bit as we look at the last 22 years. As all returns do fluctuate, there's your seven-year average. And when we compare that to their actuarial rate, it's pretty good. The reason it's pretty good right now, though, is because they had a 22% earnings rate in 21.
Yeah, that was a good year, no doubt.
So right now we're even at the seven-year average, but I'm not sure that'll be the case in the next year or the next year or two. It'll go down slightly.
Well, I want to make sure we make the point that we continue to make our full ARC payments and then probably either set aside some additional reserve payments so that if the performance continues to deteriorate, or it even goes flat sideways. I mean, I monitor the equity market very closely. And even though there's a projection for entering a recessionary investment period, we still have a very high expected rate of return. And we've got to make sure that we don't start going negative again.
Absolutely, Mayor. And again, that is something that the city manager and I have talked about bringing forward as part of the strategic plan, is some guidelines and some approaches to funding a reserve so that the council can, in a budget year with poor performance and, oh, we have $2 million liability again, use that reserve to bring it up, wait to see if the markets respond, whatever. It'll be a decision councils can make, but we got to get some structure to that, and we didn't want to try to rush it and bring it as part of this. We're required to do this as part of state law, have you adopt these things. We want to bring it through a methodical approach through the next year budget process to set up a policy that will meet the goals of council.
I mean, it's clear to me that Tier 3 continues to kind of overperform. And as more new public safety officers enter Tier 3, then I don't think we have a long-term concern about that. But we still have a lot of Tier 1, 2 retirees that are dependent on the performance of the PSPRS board. And I'd certainly like to be slightly overfunded than to see an underfunding start to grow again.
Well, again, those are the discussions we can have as we put the policy together. And again, Tier 3 is doing great, and I think Tier 3 is structured to perform well, but I would also caution that Tier 3 is also only 5 years old, so nobody's retired yet.
That's true. Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Mayor. Mark, I had a question, and I think you said this during the budget process, but can you refresh my memory? When we retired PSPRS, how much was that funding, the 443 tax, how much were we getting in revenue from that on a monthly basis, just out of curiosity? Do you remember?
On an annual basis?
Yeah, even an annual
basis. It's about $16 million, I believe.
$16 million, okay.
Percent, yes.
Thank you.
16
cents. Just a question I had. Thank you.
Yeah.
It was pretty much close to, in round terms, about $1 million a month.
Yeah, a little bit more, actually, yes.
1.3.
1.3. Thank you very much, Mayor Pro Tem. Any other questions or concerns? Councilwoman can tell me.
You go ahead, Steve. Oh. We're having problems with our...
Thank you, Connie. Mark, when they estimate a return, an actuarial return, over what period of time is that return?
Thank you, Councilman. Excellent point. Actuarial rate of returns are over a long period of time. And, you know, they try, as the board looks at these actuary assumptions, you can't whipsaw these things, you know, way down because markets are poor or way up. You want to gradually move them. So yes, you're looking over the life of the pension, which can be, you know, hundreds of years if it's an active pension. This one, of course, has a drop dead date of whenever the last active member. We have no more people going into it, so. It is over a long period, 20, 30-year time.
Thank you.
Long answer to a short question, sorry.
All right, Councilwoman can tell me.
Thank you, Mayor. Mark, I remember when we were analyzing Proposition 443 and the onset of Tier 3, I remember seeing a number as Tier 1 and 2 start to drop off and retire, and Tier 3 takes over. The estimated time, I believe, was 23 years. Do you remember that at all?
I think what you're referring to is the amortization period that the board allocated to tiers one and two, that they would all have to be fully funded by a closed amortization period. So at that time it was 23, now it's down to like 17. So that just makes for those that aren't close to fully funded, it makes their amounts go up every year as things are missed. Fortunately, our voters chose to give us 443, which allowed us to get this thing paid off, so we will have less of an issue with that. But I think you're referring to that closed amortization period.
Thank you.
Sure.
Councilmember Rusing.
I just wanted to say that, make sure the voters know that, you know, we paid off one part, but we will have a continuing commitment with the unfunded pension liability, the ARC annual requirement contribution every year. Can you look in your crystal ball and tell us what you think maybe the average might be?
Well, and again, if you're fully funded, the portion of the ARC related to unfunded pension liability would be zero. Again, whatever you have, if it's $1 million, it'll be $1 million amortized over the remaining life on this closed period, which is, like we were talking, 17 years now. So it really depends. It is definitely much lower than the 100% that we had a few years ago on the pension cost.
City Manager?
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. I think as Mark's mentioning, so the unfunded liability that was in the report was about $8 million. That was as of July 1st of last year. In that time, we had the sales tax in place, so it would make some sense that we were able to apply some more funding towards that. But to Mark's point, when you have a very slight change in the rate of return on the board's decision, that is going to increase your unfunded liability if you have one, and it's going to increase your annual contribution that you have to make. If they make changes to lifespan of employees, you're going to have to make more contributions to both of those. So we're tracking it very closely. We think that it's probably time now that we've gotten to close to, zero. Well, I'm going to say that lightly, but, you know, close to zero unfunded liability, that it's a good time for us to explore what are some good council policies that can be in place for pension policy. And I think that's what we would like to be able to explore and bring back to the council so that we can be in a good position and hopefully keep as close, you know, it's never always zero, but try to keep it as close to that we can get it.
So. If I could just add, I don't think I fully understood Councilmember Rusing's question. The zero relates to the unfunded portion. There is still the normal cost arc. And if we look at this graph that's up there right now, the normal cost for tier three and tier one and two without an unfunded liability is right around 12 or 13% a year, which is the same place that ASRS is. So we'll see that red and that blue line, colors chosen appropriately, of course, will merge close to that green line as we move forward in time.
Very good. Any other questions or concerns? So I'll entertain a motion on this item.
Mayor, I move that we adopt resolution number 2023-1853.
Second.
Second.
Motion is second. Please vote.
And Mayor and Council, as some of you have probably noticed, some of the functionality is off on your iPads. If you could please simply raise your hands when you request to speak, and then if you can just affirm your vote by saying yes or no, I would greatly appreciate it. It might make the process a little bit easier. Thank you.
Very good. All in favor, raise your hand and say aye, I guess.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Good. It's approved unanimously. All right. We now move to item 9A. Liquor license.
Public hearing and consideration for a new Series 12 restaurant liquor license application from Jason Reed Perkins, applicant for Papa's Italian, location 129 and a half North Cortez Street. The application fees have been paid and the signs have been posted for the required 20 days. Staff has reviewed the application and determined that it is in compliance. No public comments have been received.
Is the applicant present?
So he's not here. He's actually cooking right now. So I am Vanessa, his wife. So I'm just here to represent him. And we're just really happy and honored to purchase a place like Papa's. And we are just very blessed.
Well, I know Papa's Italian has been around in a couple of locations here for quite a few years. And can you tell us a little bit about your plans and what your background is? I know that you purchased that, and I think you're intending to keep the menu pretty much the same and those kind of things, right?
Yeah, totally. So I grew up in Santa Fe in New Mexico, and Jason grew up in South Carolina, Greenville. We moved to Prescott about 13 years ago because of the Hacienda Inn. So we worked for La Fonda Hotel in Santa Fe that owned Hacienda at that point. So they brought my husband and I was the food and beverage of Hacienda for 8 years. He was the executive chef for 9. So if you came to Hacienda between 2011 and 2019, we were definitely part of that team, and it was great and awesome. And he took a little break through COVID, and we have 2 young girls, 4 and 9. I went and worked for Founding Fathers Collective, so I helped Grant and Jesse open that place a couple years ago. And so, yeah, but we do want to keep that store background. We want to keep Papa's remain the same, and we have right now 25 employees that have been there for a really long time, and the menu, and we love people. So we're just really excited to serve Prescott community as business owners. So, yeah.
Well, we certainly appreciate it. I know that's one of my favorite places to go. So good luck with that. And thank you for investing and being able to continue that great tradition.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'll entertain a motion.
Mayor, I move to close the public hearing.
Second. A motion is second. Please vote.
Aye.
All in favor, raise your hand and say aye.
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 Thank you.
Passes 7-0. Very good.
Mayor, I move to approve the recommendation for liquor license number 244931 for a new Series 12 restaurant liquor license application for Papa's Italian, location 129 and a half North Cortez Street.
Second.
Motion and second. Please vote by raising your hand and saying aye.
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 Thank you. Passes 7-0.
Very good. Again, good luck, and we'll look forward to seeing you down there whenever we can get a reservation. All right, we'll move on to the regular agenda.
Thank you, Mayor. Would you like me to go forward?
Would you please? Yes.
Okay. The first item is for the approval of 5 Public Works job order contracting contracts for horizontal construction services. And I just wanted to give a little context around this. This is the first job order contract for the city. This is a tried and true approach that really allows to deal with time sensitive and routine installation projects when we would when we need to address them fairly quickly. And this is specific to horizontal construction. So this isn't anything vertical. This is just your water lines, wastewater lines, streets, those types of things. Contractors are selected that are selected for this are pre-qualified based on their qualifications, performance, and availability to be called upon for those qualified projects. And there's limits to with the size and the cost of those projects that they're able to be called upon for. And this afternoon, Tim Sherwood is here. He's our capital programs manager. He's going to kind of walk us through and present the city's first job order contract to council.
Thank you, Katie. Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. Tim Sherwood, Public Works, Capital Program Manager. And so I'll give you a little background. I will touch probably on a couple things that Katie already did, but so job order contracting is outlined very clearly in ARS section 34-604. There's a lot of do's and don'ts in there. There are 4 primary methods for delivery of construction contracts per ARS. There is design, bid, build, which is most of the contracts we bring to you. We design a contract, we put it out to bid, we construct it. There's design, build contracts. We do a handful of those each year. Most of the time they have to do with buildings. You bring an architect or an engineer on board, then they work with a contractor to build something. Construction manager at risk, or is what you've heard as a CMAR, which is how we're building our water production facility and intermediate pump station project. Again, it's a collaboration of engineering and construction. And then job order contracting, which is new to the city of Prescott. We have used it in other applications. We've used the statewide program in the past. We've used cooperative use contracts in the past. But this is the first time that Prescott has initiated a job order contracting program. So what is job order contracting? It's a project delivery method utilizing an on-call construction services contract where construction work and performance is determined by issuing job orders with the contractor during a fixed period. So how are contractors selected? All contractors on our list are based off qualifications. The city advertised for a request of statement of qualifications to the community back in February. On March 9th, the city received a total of 12 submittals, 5 from local contractors, 7 from contractors that were out of town. RSOQ, which is the request for statement of qualification requirements, is a description of service to be provided, which is horizontal construction. Horizontal construction has to do with streets, concrete work, flat work, water lines, sewer lines, etc. Basically, if it's flat, it covers horizontal construction covers it. There are selection criteria that are outlined in the SOQ that have to be met or a requirement for each contractor. There's a total of 4 categories and they're weighted accordingly. So the 4 categories are general information, which is valued at 10 points in the SOQ, experience and qualifications of the contractor and key personnel, which is valued at 50 points, value added knowledge and experience, which touches a little bit on local knowledge, local firms, is worth 30 points, and then an overall evaluation, which the committee, which I'll explain in a second, the committee gets together and talks about, which is only worth 10 points at the very end. So you can see the point system is weighted heavily towards experience, personnel, local knowledge, et cetera, but not weighted in such a way that it disqualifies one contractor from another. So our selection panel, we selected 5 members for our panel. 3 members of that panel were Public Works employees. 2 of them were registered professional engineers in the state of Arizona. And 1 of them was a senior management employee from a local licensed contractor who did not submit on this project. All of those are requirements of ARS for a selection panel. Panel members are required to review and score each firm, not rank. They score each firm based off the submittal. They do it independently and shall only consider the criteria that I mentioned previously. That's what you're looking at is the statement that is submitted by the contractor, and that's what you review off of. Panel members may not request or consider any fees or other cost information from the contractor. That is not part of this process. Scores are compiled, and panel members met on May 9th of this year, and the panel members evaluated the scores. We had discussions and prepared a list of the five best qualified firms that submitted for this particular statement of qualifications. So awarding JOC contracts, once we have our list of our final five, how do we go about awarding it? As Katie mentioned, several municipalities across the state have JOC programs. It's a common practice amongst many public works departments. Having a JOC program can help the city procure horizontal construction contracts for emergencies or projects that are smaller, simpler in scope, maybe a specialized application that a contractor does. Council back in October awarded a very similar contract to four firms for vertical work, so firms that do building and such. So that was awarded back in October. Once a project's been identified, the city enters negotiations with the selected firm from the list that the city feels is the most qualified to do that particular job order. If negotiations are unsuccessful, the city can terminate negotiations with that contractor and potentially enter negotiations with another contractor on the list, or terminate the procurement altogether and maybe choose to go to bid or something else. Once you terminate negotiations with a contractor, you cannot return to them. So for instance, if you enter a negotiation with a contractor, you just can't come to a price and you go to the second one. If your price comes in higher, you can't go back to the lower price. So the other thing is, you cannot use the five contractors on the list in a bidding situation. You cannot bid the five contractors against each other. It's very clear in ARS that that's not possible. Our maximum contract amounts that we're looking for are no more than $1 million per job order and no more than $3 million per contractor per fiscal year. This contract expires.
Tim, I want to interrupt you a minute.
Absolutely.
So you're talking about per project.
Yes, sir.
So if one contractor isn't accepted, you can't go back, but he's still an active contractor for future projects.
Absolutely, yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. This contract will expire on June 30th of 2025, and that is actually ARS mandated. ARS is reevaluating. They're going to rewrite the policy on both JOC contracts and CMAR, effective July 1 of 2025. So that's the longest we could go with this contract. There's also no guarantee of work here. Just because a contractor is selected does not mean it's much like our on-call contract for professional services. There is no guarantee of work for anybody that submitted or was selected. A separate amendment to each contractor must be issued for each job order that is negotiated. If it exceeds our administrative amount, we will be in front of council to ask for approval of a job order contract. City standard construction contract will be used for all job order contracts. So there's really nothing different there. It's just a little bit different way of procuring services. And with that, I will be happy to answer any questions.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to say, I think this is, I talked to Katie about, she alluded to this morning when she and I were talking about some other stuff. And I think this is things we can do to make our ability to respond to infrastructure issues that might crop up in the city, that we can make anything we can do to make that process more efficient, I think is a big win. And it sounds like you guys have done a lot of due diligence to make sure not only are we using the best, most qualified people, some of the people on this list are local, which is great. I'd like to see that. But you're complying with all the ARS statute on it. So it sounds great. And I appreciate the approach to kind of, it sounds like probably my guess is modernizing our approach to this a little bit. If other communities in the state are probably already doing this kind of work, I'm happy to see this because I know there are issues that crop up where we're not able to be responsive in dealing with emergency situations. So this is great. Thank you.
Councilwoman Cantelmi.
Thank you, Mayor. Tim, I think I talked to you about this when we first heard about it, and my only concern was, and I'd like to hear your opinion about it, was bypassing the competitive bid process, because the changing goalposts are the actual projects. No problem using a certified amount of builders, but I do worry about the competitive bidding process going away. We do have the advantage that they're there and waiting for us. But what's your thought on that? Have you seen that? Because like you said, if we can't go back, we decide to excuse one of them and move on. And then we realize, oh, wow, we really misunderstood the bid, the scope of work, if you will. And then we don't have an opportunity to go back and save some money. So what's your opinion on that?
The purpose of a JOC program is to focus on quality and value. It's not necessarily about price per se. We also have bid situations where we get a low bid, and the primary difference between this and a JOC is when you open a bid, you know everybody's numbers. But we've also had low bids that weren't qualified. They've been qualified through just their contractor themselves, or there's some line item in their bid that's not fair and balanced, and so we have to go to the next one. Once you do that, you can't go back to the low bidder either. The advantage in a bid situation is you know everybody's numbers at that point. So like I said, this is based off, the primary goal of this is based off qualifications. You're getting the out of the 12 submittals we got, these are the five best contractors that were on that list.
Well, so what's your perceived problem if they're going to go back and review this? Because when I hear that, there's got to be a glitch somewhere. So why are they going back to review this process?
I'm not sure I understand what you mean about review. I just think it's probably, it's a step. This, I don't know how long this particular program has been in place. So I just think it's one of those evaluations, and maybe because 2025 is a nice, you know, five or a zero, maybe that's when they decided they wanted to do it. I don't have any background on it. We were just made aware of that in the process of procuring this. Our contract specialist made us aware of it, and then we also heard about it through some meetings with AGC.
Is there anything that you're uncomfortable with?
Not at all. And we keep a very good record of current bid prices, and so we know when something's fair and when something's not fair. And then like any other type thing, it's going to be a negotiation. And if we're not comfortable, we're not going to pull the trigger. We're going to go, like I said, either go to another contractor or we'll look to actually maybe put it out to bid. This is a huge time saver. If I had to take a project out to bid tomorrow, I'm probably 8 weeks from standing in front of you folks.
So, can I ask you one more last thing?
Sure, absolutely.
So I think what happens in a lot of the contracts is the scope changes. Mm-hmm. So what are you doing about that in terms of, do you go out with a scope? And do they come back to you and go, hey, you forgot about this, and now it's going to be a change order?
I think in a lot of situations, this could be used for emergency services. Well, that's going to be the city and the contractor working together to develop the scope. In an item that we'll talk about here in a few minutes, we actually had a set of plans, a set of specs, a bid schedule. Everything that we would normally take to bid is already there and prepared. So it's just a matter of them filling out the documents, us having some negotiations back and forth, and we move forward. So it's going to depend on what the situation is. I can think of several projects fairly recently that this would have been a huge help for us to help relieve some of the burden on our utility folks. In the instance of that water main on 6th Street, this could have been a huge help for us. The potholes that occurred over the back at the end of the winter, we could have brought somebody on board very quickly to help assist the streets department with pothole repairs. So this could be a very valuable tool in our toolbox.
Thank you.
Katie, I think you've had some experience with us in your previous position. Can you enlighten us?
Yeah, I'd like to just start by saying that not every project is the right project for a job order contract. And so that's part of the role of the Public Works Department and Tim and his team to be looking at which projects should we go out to bid for, which projects should we, and what procurement or what type of construction management, you know, what type, do we want a CMAR? Do we want to go, you know, design, bid, build? So there's a lot of pieces to that, but I just wanted to point out that this is for very specific types of projects, mostly projects that need that immediate attention, and this is used very regularly. In my experience, it has been a huge asset to have that as part of your overall tools, as Tim said, in your toolbox. So I highly, you know, I'm very comfortable with this, and I think Tim's trying to give you the, you know, all of the do's and don'ts about it, but I think the benefits of having something like this outweigh any of the concerns that I would ever have for it. And to the question about why they're looking at it, I believe this was an authorized program for a period of time, and it's coming to its end. So now they're likely to reauthorize it, because I think you're going to get a lot of support for it, but there might be little tweaks to the program.
Councilmember Rusing.
Thank you. It sounds like this will be making your department more nimble, more responsible.
Absolutely.
And I mean, responsive. You're already responsible and efficient. And when you brought up that it'll help repair the potholes in the water mains in a more timely fashion.
It's just, like I said, it's just an example of something that could come up. Yeah. If, like I said, if a major water break was to happen, this is a method for us to get on the ball immediately. And one of the highlights of some of the better RSOQs we received was how they detailed how they respond to JOC. Or when a request goes out, how quickly they respond to you, asking the pertinent questions before you even start with a negotiation.
Well, it sounds like it'll be a wonderful relationship with these contractors. Thank you.
Any other questions or concerns from the council? Any public comment?
No, Mayor.
Well, I know Tim's got a tie on, so we'll go ahead and entertain a motion here.
When Mayor, you wear one, I wear one.
Mayor, I move to approve city contract number 2023-208 with Cactus Asphalt, a division of Cactus Transport.
Second.
Motion is second. Please vote by raising your hand and saying aye.
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 Thank you. Passes 7-0.
Mayor, I make a motion to approve city contract number 2023-209 with Combs Construction Company.
Second.
Motion is second. Please vote by raising your hand and saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Passes 7-0.
Very good.
Mayor, I make a motion to approve city contract number 2023-210 with Fan Contracting, Inc.
Second.
Motion is second. Please indicate your vote, raising your hand and saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you. Passes 7-0.
Mayor, I make a motion to approve city contract number 2023-211 with J. Banneke Construction, Inc.
Second.
Motion is second. Please indicate your vote by raising your hand and saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you. Passes 7-0.
Mayor, I make a motion to approve city contract number 2023-2112 with Sunland Asphalt and Construction, LLC.
So I think you meant 212, not 2112.
I'm sorry. 212? Okay.
Second. Okay, motion is second. Please indicate your support by raising your hand and saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you. Passes 7-0. And I think, is everybody clear on the fact that you should raise your hand and say aye when you're voting so that maybe we don't have to say that every single time? Thank you.
Here we go again. All right. That concludes that item 10A. So we're going to 10B.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. There is a method to our madness. So the council agenda, as it was put together today, was very intentional because the next item is the approval of the contract, an IGA with the Prescott Unified School District for the 6 workforce housing units at Taylor Hicks Elementary School. Over the past year, the City of Prescott and PUSD have engaged in discussions regarding workforce housing and the challenges that our local workforce faces in finding affordable housing. And the City and PUSD have worked together to develop a pilot project to address the housing shortage, or small part of the housing shortage of teachers, for teachers and public safety employees. So I do have Interim Community Development Director Chelsea Walton here to share an overview of the IGA and answer questions. When she's done, we're going to talk about using our JOC contract to get the work done.
Great. Thank you, Katie. Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council members. Chelsea Walton, Interim Director, Community Development. I have this distinct pleasure in presenting this workforce housing agreement and taking you through the terms today. Wanted to start just with a brief background. The workforce housing, everyone knows that it's an impact, it's an issue that's impacting communities all around the world right now. It's very nuanced and complicated, which is why it's probably not resolved at this point. So, with no simple solution and not one fix, this we are coming together as a community with the Workforce Housing Committee that was newly appointed this past May. We're coming together so that we can continue to have good discussions and, more importantly, act with diligence for tangible results, especially when solutions are presented to us. And such is the case with this item. So last year, as Katie mentioned, POSD approached the city. They found a grant that could be used for teacher housing. They have since been awarded those monies, and this agreement is meant to memorialize how the city intends to be a partner in this flagship workforce housing project. So this is a site plan of the proposed Teacher Village, where six units will be constructed. The manufactured home units are, as we'll see, in production. But this particular item may look small as it relates to the workforce housing overall the issue, but it's a start, and it's a good start. And even this particular project is going to improve the city's recruitment capabilities, as I'm sure the fire and police chiefs can agree that it's a powerful tool to offer top candidates that might have to move from out of state. So without further ado, I'd like to take you through a couple of the terms of the agreement. And we're going to start off with looking at the PUSD obligations. So PUSD in this agreement is providing for and paying for the necessary equipment, labor, resources to build the units. Four of the units will be dedicated to PUSD teachers, and two of the units will be dedicated to the city. PUSD will be installing the utility yard lines from the meter boxes to each unit. They're going to complete a landlord agreement. This is for utility billing to be able to bill each of the individual tenants. They're going to be responsible for all ongoing and future maintenance costs. They'll manage the units for the duration of the IGA, but this obviously does not preclude them from hiring a third party to do the management for them, which they've already secured. They will also, PUSD will retain the ownership of the units and the underlying real property upon which the units sit. Any questions before we move forward? All right. So the city obligations. It's a short list, but it's a mighty list. The city is going to be responsible for providing the preliminary design and plan drafting for the provision of wet utilities. The city will waive the fees for plan review, permitting, and inspections. And then the city is going to provide for the water main infrastructure installation, including each of the box yoke assemblies for the unit's connection to the new water main. Before we continue with the rest of the terms of the agreement, I want to dig in a little bit
to interrupt you for a moment. Mayor Pro Tem had a question.
Chelsea, you may be getting to this, so I apologize if I'm cutting you off from answering my question already. But do you have an idea of what the seems like a lot of this is kind of like an in-kind component of what the city is going to use staff time perhaps for? Is there a financial number that's attached to this? I knew you had the answer already.
So the project total cost is going to be around $1.6 million. And the associated part that the city will play as it relates to that list that was on the prior slide is about $503,000. So Mr. Tim Sherwood, our capital projects manager, is going to dig into that $448,000 number. Wanted to point out that number came in much higher than staff originally anticipated, but thanks to the Public Works team and Tim in particular, he was able to negotiate that down considerably. And then, of course, he's going to speak to that and can provide more specifics as it relates to the numbers. But as you can see from just the base project cost and then what the city's obligations amount to, we're going to roughly pay a third of the initial cost for the project. But the city is going to be receiving the benefit of a third, two of the six units, for the next 50 years, potentially. And we'll talk more about the term length in a moment. Any questions on this before we move forward?
50 years?
With the extension, yes, sir. The term, initial term length is 30, and there is a option for automatic renewal, which is 20 years, and that would carry it to 50 years total potentially.
Understood.
Question.
Councilman Moore.
Thank you, Mayor. Chelsea, I know that some of this project is being funded with grant funds that PUSD is receiving. Will the city be reimbursed any of this amount through those grant funds?
No, this fund is going to be from the city, and it's for the what we're receiving back, which is the two units and the use of them over the term of the agreement.
To follow up with that question, I know that the people who will be living in these units will be paying rent. Mm-hmm. So will the school district be receiving rent for the four and the city will receive rent for the two?
No, sir.
If we're getting the benefit for having these two, it seemed like we would get the financial benefit as well, since we're putting out the money for those two units that would be putting out.
Sure. So no, the intent is to provide these units at a below market rate, and really the rents are going to be contributing to the overall management, the ongoing life management of the units themselves. So even if the city was receiving the rent monies, they wouldn't be commensurate to the amount that would be required for the ongoing maintenance. So the PUSD school district has, in their obligations, taken over the management and associated repair and maintenance costs of the units, and they'll be receiving those funds to go toward the ongoing maintenance.
Mr. Mayor?
Councilmember Rusing.
Chelsea, you mentioned waiving fees for permit costs, inspections. Any idea what the value is and the cost of waiving all those fees?
Yes, ma'am. We've calculated those at about $3,406. That is for the plan review fees. It's not a huge number, but that is up on the screen for you, ma'am. Any other questions before I move on? We've got some more terms to go through, so perhaps more.
Please proceed.
Thank you, sir. All right. So the timeline, and Tim touched on what the JOC or JOC program can afford us, and this is a case in point. So as a partner with PUSD, one of the other very valuable resources the city brings to the table is the gift of time. And with the JOC potential, we can provide a very aggressive timeline that our partners in this program would probably not have been able to do under other circumstances. So as you can see from the screen, the units are currently constructed and being stored. The foundations are set to be poured and completed late in June. The units will then be delivered to the site in potentially late June, early July, and then proposed utility construction will commence in late June and potentially be completed early July. Site and interior finish work, July, August, and tentative project completion early September at this point. Wonderful. So I don't see any questions. I'll keep moving forward, sir. The other lease terms that we have are the IGA terms are the lease conditions. So the lease terms for the tenants and per the agreement between the PUSD and city tenants are to be identical, except that the city can determine longer or shorter lease durations, even if they're different from PUSD. Like we discussed, the PUSD will receive all rental proceeds and non-refundable deposits and any other monetary proceeds from the units. By May of each year, each of the tenants are to notify PUSD or the property manager whether they will be renewing their lease or not for the upcoming year. And then since the purpose of the whole Teachridge and project is to provide workforce housing at rates potentially lower than market rate, PUSD is going to determine an amount that is generally equal or range to one-third of the average tenant's monthly net income. And then the rent will be charged and could be amended from time to time in an amount that's deemed reasonable at PUSD's discretion. I won't read the rest.
Mayor
of that,
Pro Tem, you had a question.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. And this might be Chelsea a question for the school district, but my question is, in the planning and zoning presentation, my impression was that the units were be designed to be short term in nature. Mm-hmm. Is that going to be spelled out in the lease? So I guess what I'm trying to guard against in my mind is that you have someone who moves in and they just continue to struggle, have a hard time finding a place to live in the community. That would be unfortunate. And I guess I imagine there's some leniency there to be put in place, but I'm just curious what that is designed to look like, practically speaking.
Yes. And that is a provision in later on in the agreement, but I believe the city attorney had a comment.
I can address that. Essentially, I think PUSD's goal is to have it as a one-year item, but the city has discretion on who is to go into those locations. So if it's longer than a year for the two city units, we can do that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wonderful. Any other questions on this slide? All right. Just a couple of other. Oh.
Councilwoman Cantelmi.
Thank you very much, Mayor. Chelsea, thank you for bringing this up. This is good. I'm sitting as the liaison for the Workforce Housing Committee. One of the things we've been discussing are requirements from potential tenants. Mm-hmm. So will there be built into this any kind of a requirement for them to do what it's intended, to save up a little money for potentially a down payment? How does that work without violating their rights? Because
sure.
The point is to give them a leg up for a year. So the presumption is the reduced rate, they should be saving the balance of it, I would hope,
absolutely,
to move up into what we've been calling the good, better, best program or the mid-range. So has that been addressed with this unit? Because a year's not very long.
Right. So this IGA does not address that in particular. Each of the parties is going to determine employee eligibility on their own, from their own organizational practices and what they need from this project. But I'll go ahead and move to the next slide, because one of the points touches on that, because one of the other IGA terms is that the city will determine, this is the last bullet point, city will determine which of its employees qualify as essential workers and who will be housed in its allotted units. So obviously the PUSD has the same discretion, but as it relates to that last bullet point, the police and fire chief will be meeting with the HR director very soon to really flesh this out and figure out a good program that provides what we need it to do. So as Mayor Pro Tem Montoya pointed out, these are intended to be shorter term rentals that really I could see being used as more of a recruitment tool. You can imagine some of the best qualified candidates might be from out of state, and giving them a place to land for a year or maybe 2 years, if it's determined to do that, would give them a good ability to scout the community and find a good place to live. So there are only two of the units that the city will have in its arsenal, but we are going to be working on an employee eligibility program and what it looks like for this specific project, as well as any future projects that might be longer term.
Thank you, Chelsea. Joe, real quickly, can you think of off the top of your head, if we make a requirement for the potential tenant to save a certain amount of money, are we violating any of his civil rights? Or, I mean, is there anything we're violating by making that a requirement?
No, I don't think that's a problem if we make it a requirement for living in that location. I think doing so could be done through a payroll deduction or something else, but this is voluntary. And I think it's important that it's not in the IGA, because this is something we want to establish, not something we want to agree with PUSD on. But we could make those part of the requirements as we go forward.
You know, I did the math on these. So if they were rentable at, let's say, $1,600, and this is hypothetical, we give it to them at $1,100, that's a potential of $500 a month for 1 year, 12 months. That's still not a ton of money. But I think this bears a lot of looking into, but it's a great idea.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for those comments. So just in brief.
Chelsea, I think I was just doing a little back of the napkin calculation here. So if we have $500,000 in general that we're submitting to help this project proceed, and we amortize that over 50 years. We're talking about maybe $5,000 per unit per year, and that's kind of a minimal, I don't know, support for two different public safety officers to be able to locate here and then identify where they might be able to have a long-term residency. So I think that does benefit the city at a very minimal cost if you amortize it over that 50-year cycle.
Thank you, sir.
Correct.
Sounds good to me.
May I, real quickly, because sure. One of the things that we've discussed is whether or not we are going to be providing them, ideally, a path to home ownership, or do we have a combination thereof? Do we provide them a path to just find something that would be more permanent, but it'd be a rental situation? Because some of the members of the group were concerned that they would never own a home. Although, you know, some would argue the studies are, well, millennials don't want to own a home, but I don't know that that's always the case, especially after a child or two comes along. But there's just so many things that kind of need to be explored.
Absolutely.
What the goal is, really.
Right. And that may be addressed with future projects. I think this is a flagship project and can be used as a recruitment tool. But those are absolutely things that I look forward to exploring with the Workforce Housing Committee.
Thank you, Chelsea.
Thank you. All right, so briefly, a few other items that are terms in this IGA with PUSD. Potential restrictions on the use of alcohol, tobacco, and the possession of firearms. This is a school campus, so PUSD will be complying with Arizona Revised State Statute regarding the possession of firearms on school property, but they do understand that there may be police officers that will be staying in these units. So they're exploring that with their legal counsel. I mentioned the term length is set at 30 years with an automatic renewal for an additional 20 years. So we're potentially looking at the 50 years that Mr. Mayor mentioned.
Quick comment on that. I just wanted to let the council know that our original intent was a 20-year with a 20-year renewal. Once we started understanding costs and again, that $1.6 million is one-time costs with us doing about 500 and, what was the number, 500 and?
503.
The school district is going to take on all the ongoing costs for those, but we did negotiate an additional 10 years for that, and that was upon suggestion of the mayor to possibly see if we could do that. And the school district was very amenable to that, just based on the cost of what the city is putting in.
Wonderful, thank you. We touched on the term length. The vacant units, this kind of goes back to the fact that this is the goal of this project is to make sure that we have what we need and people housed, and we all know that we have people that need this housing. So we want to make sure that we get the bang for the buck, if you will. So in the IGA, there is a specific provision regarding vacant units. So if the city doesn't intend to or cannot provide a tenant for our two units for more than 3 months in any one-year period, were to notify PUSD, and then PUSD may allow one of their essential workers to occupy the unit for a period of 1 year, and then they would continue to do that until the city notifies that we're ready and have another tenant that would like to use the units, and we just have to notify them as in writing when that need arises, and then allow the any essential worker that's in those units to their agreement to expire. I don't see that happening initially, but it was important to put it in case the need arises over the next 30 to 50 years. Any questions on those terms? I'll put the site plan back up, but that's the end of the presentation as it relates to the terms of the IGA.
Well, very good. Councilman Moore.
Thank you, Mayor. Joe, I just have a question for legal counsel for the city. Is the city potentially setting up themselves for a situation where maybe a developer or some other entity in the community would come forward and say, well, we want to provide affordable housing in the community, workforce housing, and we want the city to provide us with a benefit? I mean, that's a substantial benefit that the city's providing. And I just want to make sure that we're not setting a precedent where we would be obligated or in the public's eye, we're doing something that maybe we shouldn't be doing down the road as we move forward with the Workforce Housing Committee.
I don't think it does establish a precedent. And I think the major reason why it doesn't is because this is an agreement with another governmental agency. And so just like a gift clause, for example, analysis is different when we're dealing with another governmental agency, so is an IGA. And so I don't think it binds us in any way. And I know you're not saying it binds us legally because it doesn't, but I don't think it also establishes a precedence because of the different nature of a government entity versus a developer.
Any other questions for me, sir?
Well, if there's no other questions, do we have any public comment here?
We do not, Mayor.
All right. In that case, I'll entertain a motion on this item.
Mayor, I move to approve city contract number 2023-224.
Second.
Motion and second. Please vote. Raise your hand and say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Any opposed? I think it passes
6-0. Councilman Tenney has abstained from voting. Thank you all. Can we put the site plan back up?
Mayor, next item on the agenda is the approval of the contract for the PUSD Affordable Housing Project. And Tim Sherwood is here. So these were kind of all wrapped together. He's going to go over the JOC contract that is recommended to complete the city's portion of the improvements contemplated.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. Tim Sherwood, Public Works, Capital Program Manager. I'm here for you today is approval of a construction contract for the items that we've just discussed. The city's the construction contract for this will install a new water main and sewer services to these six units. You may be asking why the six units are kind of skewed the way they are, and that has to do a lot with the existing utilities that are there. The sewer line runs diagonally where the one unit is kind of tilted at about a 45-degree angle. That sewer main was only installed about 4 years ago. They'll tie directly into that where there's sewer services, but so there's no sewer main has to be done there. We looked at it early on about relocating that sewer main, pretty cost prohibitive to do so. The water main will be tied in on the existing line on Campbell Street, pretty much runs right through the center of the project right there. You can see where it extends beyond the units and then starts heading to the south. We're not doing that portion at this time, but it will be something that we can do in the future to help with being able to loop our system in that particular neighborhood. In the interest of keeping this project moving forward, keeping design, things like that, we're bringing the water line into a point where all the meters can be set, but they'll be installed in such a way that we can tie into it in the future. The project was designed by Kimley Horn and was completed about 3 weeks ago on the schedule that we promised the school district. The city selected to use a job order contracting contract for this particular item for many of the reasons that we discussed earlier. This is a project that needs to be done fundamentally by the end of the summer. If we were to take this out to a competitive bid situation, again, I would be standing in front of you until probably the end of August. So the city at the time selected FAN Contracting as the contractor to enter negotiations with for this particular project based off their qualifications. FAN's final price was $448,836. Our final engineer's estimate was $405,000. I will tell you that the price came down considerably after the first submittal from the contractor and subsequent negotiations. The project also includes post-design services from Kinley Horn for $17,520 to do the as-builts and survey work for this project. Staff has reviewed and the proposal submitted by FAN Contracting, and much in the same way we do on any competitive bid situation, we have verified their license, bonding, references, and past performance of previous municipal projects, and has been completed and deemed satisfactory. The city's standard construction contract will be used for this project, and funding for this project is budgeted and available in FY24 from both water and wastewater funds. And I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
Councilmember Rusing.
Thank you. Tim, how many linear feet are we talking about on this water main? I know POSD is going to be doing the yard lines, but how?
There's close to 500 feet. I think it was 470 something feet total. Mm-hmm. The water line will be an 8-inch water line to a point. I wish I could point the map. There's a fire hydrant adjacent to the furthest unit on the left that's running north and south. So there's an 8-inch line that runs to that point, then it's reduced to a 6-inch line to subsequently feed the meters.
Okay.
One of the ideas early on was that we would just do a master meter here, but it was determined a long term it's better to have an individual meter for each unit. Mm-hmm. And so thus the water main is being extended down beyond the last unit there.
Okay, thank you. Uh-huh.
Any other questions or concerns? Do we have any public comment?
We do not.
All right, then I'll entertain a motion on item 10C.
Mayor, I move to approve city contract number 2023-210A1.
Second.
Yeah, motion and second. Please vote by raising your hand and saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you. Passes 6-0, Councilman Tenney.
And Mayor, I move to approve city contract number 2023-161A1.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Please vote by raising your hand, saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Passes 6-0.
Very good. Now we'll go to 10D.
Thank you, Mayor. Following up to the council budget workshops that were held on May 11th and May 25th, I am very happy to present the FY 2024 tentative budget. This is an important step in the annual budget process, and of course, the tentative budget sets the maximum appropriation for the city for next fiscal year. And Mark Woodfill is here, and the city's finance director, and he'll present the recommended tentative budget.
Thank you, Manager. As we get into this, as we're sitting here, Tyler and I get an email from the league that in our wonderful legislators' infinite wisdom, the Senate has forwarded and approved Senate Bill 1131 and sent it to the governor's office to be signed, which will eliminate our ability to tax residential rentals. So the legislature, I guess, feels that residential rentals require no municipal services. So that's a relief. As it stands,
Mayor
it has...
Mayor Pro Tem, you have a question.
Yeah, sorry, Mark. Just curious. Do you know how our representative voted on that? Do either you or Tyler know?
I do not, but I could
just
guess.
Just curious.
That might be inappropriate for me to guess, but... I doubt I'm wrong. It has an effective date of January 1st of 2025. Obviously, it's a new thing. It's going to cut revenue in the general fund by $966,000. That's approximately, what, 6 police officers? It will also cut $966,000 out of your streets program. So that's good news for streets, but they left, so they don't. As we move forward.
Mr. Mayor.
Oh, there they are.
Mr. Mayor.
She's so short. I can never see her back there.
Councilman Tenney.
Thank you, Mayor. Just to clarify, Tyler and Mark, it's been passed by the Senate and has been sent to the governor's desk, but the governor has not signed, correct?
So there's, correct.
There's still a possibility, as with multiple bills that have passed and been sent to the governor this year, the Senate fully expects that it will not be signed by the governor. There's a possibility of that as well. Is that
as the league likes to point out, and I think is a good thing to say, assuming a veto is not really a plan. For legislation, it's
fair enough.
It's more of a dare. I dare you to sign it. I guess
it's good though to reflect on how a balance in government between the political parties sometimes works to the favor of the citizenry.
And again, as obviously, new item. We knew it was a possibility as we moved through this budget. It has a 18-month implementation date, so it will not affect this year, and it will only partially affect the year after. So as we move into this budget cycle, it's really not going to change anything we're talking about today. The city manager and your finance department will work at what the cuts will look like as we move forward in time. But just to make sure you're all aware and know why we're so happy today. Budget process to date, strategic workshop on down through all the various things we have suffered through to get this budget done, and the public outreach that we have had with the two workshops, as well as the strategic planning workshop and the mid-year budget presentation workshop. The truth and taxation notice was first one was published on Sunday. I hope you all read it. It was a lovely quarter page ad, 5 pages down, I believe. Today we'll be looking at the tentative budget, and as City Manager pointed out, that sets the maximum limit. We can reduce the budget from here, but we cannot increase it if adopted, and it also orders the publication and sets the date of the public hearings. I included it just in case anybody missed it. It was, of course, not highlighted in the newspaper, the point, so I just did that. Just as a reminder, here we sit with the budget. Operating budget is 124, almost 125 million, and our total budget for the year is at 258,135,559. We look for another dollar, so it could have been a little more around, but didn't make it. With that, this, again, sets the public hearing for June 27th for the budget, also the alternative expenditure limitation public hearing, and the property tax levy public hearing. Those will all be one public hearing, but it will cover all comments on all three of those things as the public lines up for that. Following with the tax increase that council has directed me to include in this budget, a roll call vote for us to continue with the primary property tax increase will be needed. Not a problem, we're doing roll call votes today, although it'll be by name as required by statute. And then after that, at a separate meeting, for some reason, again, infinite wisdom of the legislature, want us to have a separate special meeting to adopt the final budget. That will be part of that agenda item as well. And the last item will be on July 11th, which is the consideration, the final consideration of the tax levy. With that,
I have some questions.
Thank you, Mayor. Mark, quick question for you. The vote that we're taking on the 27th and the vote that we're taking on the 11th, I get that those are both required by law. Effectively, is there any difference between what we're voting for on the 27th regarding the property tax?
The 27th is essentially approving it, but that ignored the other part of state law that requires there be a 2-week period between the public hearing and the approval of the levy. The Property Tax Oversight Commission, which is another wonderful state agency, requires that we send them the results of that roll call vote, all of our publishing documentation, and all of our worksheets within 3 days of that roll call vote. But that we cannot set the actual levy that day. We have to come back on the 11th.
Gotcha. So the 11th will be more a ministerial piece. We'll have already committed one way or the other, unless we have a change of heart.
It's not committed until you adopt the ordinance, but we can't consider the ordinance without the roll call vote.
Fantastic. Thank you for the clarification.
Not sure it was clarification, but it was the law. Anything else, Mayor? If not, I rest my case.
All right, I'll entertain a motion unless we have any public comment.
We don't.
Okay.
Mayor, I move to adopt resolution number 2023-1855.
Second.
Yeah, motion and second. Please vote by raising your hand and saying aye.
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 Thank you. Passes 7-0. This one does not require a roll call, no.
All right, then we move to item 10D.
10E? Yes. All right. So the next one is the acceptance of 3 ADOT grants for the airport. 10E, yes. And you may recall from the budget presentation on May 25th, many of the airport projects are made possible through the significant grant funding that we receive as a city. And I've got Airport Director Robin Sabata here to discuss 3 recent airport grant awards from the Arizona Department of Transportation.
Thank you, Katie. Robin Sabata, Airport Director. So this is about acceptance of 3 grants for a grand total of $1.775 million. The total match on that is just a hair under $67,000. So it's a pretty darn good deal. 2 of the grants are 100% funded by ADOT for design. One is for a new aircraft rescue and firefighting station jointly with a snow removal facility, jointly with an operations and maintenance facility. So that one would be done jointly. We will be working with the fire department to see what their needs are. One of the things we've discovered is we are going to have a larger ARF truck, aircraft rescue and firefighting truck, that we'll need. And that truck doesn't fit in the current location. It would take off the mirrors. I suppose we could take out bricks and kind of make it work, but I think it's better to look at this building, which was built in the 1970s on the south side of the airfield. It is due to be moved and also, you know, taken out of commission. Part of this design will also look at a brief site selection study, and I've talked with the chief about the possibility of where else it could be located on the airfield to also optimize its availability to the community. The second design grant is for the North Ramp Rehabilitation Project. Now, what happened is when we moved Taxiway Charlie further away from the main runway? When it did, it took off part of the North Ramp. So approximately 25 to 30 parking spots, aircraft parking spots, were lost. So this will also be a redesign to look at adding additional parking in an area sort of around the corner and the bidirectional taxiway. The third grant is the associated with the Strategic Academic Flight Education Complex, which is a SAFE grant. And that is a $600,000 grant. And that grant will be to do design and some construction work. That particular grant also has, by the legislature, an additional requirement that there's a private match, and that match of $600,000 is going to be provided by Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. And that already came in front of you with the lease that we had signed with them, that they would be making almost $5 million worth of investment. Our match on that is about $66,667. So it's altogether, it's a pretty darn good deal.
Well, congratulations, Dr. Sabata. That's talk about a return on investment. $67,000, we get $1.775 million. Keep up the good work. Councilman Tenney.
Thank you. Robin, one of your many talents is doing just what you've described, seeking and applying for and getting grants to help us expand the airport. We really, or upgrade the airport, which is what's happening here. I appreciate that. You've expressed to us that, as with all grants, there are parameters for what we need to do. With each of these grants, do you have any concerns whatsoever with our ability to be able to meet our obligations as far as what we're going to need to do to be able to receive the grants and qualify, you know, check off all the boxes for what's required of us?
We're just fine. We check off every box.
Excellent. Thank you.
Councilwoman Cantone.
Thank you, Mayor. Dr. Sabata, I've got a question about that bigger truck in the building that it won't fit in. Is that a metal building or was it a brick building?
It's a brick building.
Oh, it is. Okay. Yeah. So it's really old.
It is quite old, and it's not soundproofed, and it's right next to where aircraft run up. So I feel sorry for the firefighters that have to sleep there.
Oh, yeah.
Also in that area, the fixed-based operator, Qatar Aviation, would like to eventually expand. So this real prime real estate. So I think it's really good that we take a look at site selection on this. The airport layout plan shows it a little bit further down on the south side of the airport. We're also looking at the north side of the airport in the vicinity of the new air traffic control tower that will be designed in 25 and built thereafter.
That's great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions or concerns? Any public comment?
No, Mayor.
You know, I do want to make a point, and I've heard from some members of the community that our budget is being reduced this year from 281 to 258 million. But some people have to realize that we have to expand our budget when we submit for grants. Because if we don't include that in the budget and we actually get those grants awarded, we're not able to spend it. So we haven't had to submit additional grant requests during this next upcoming budget cycle. So that's the reason why that number has been reduced. But the very, very small request for increasing our city tax, property tax, not only provided some benefit to our general fund, but then when we get this good news on SB 1161, it makes that $238,000 a very small down payment on the double $966K that might be at risk with our rental tax. So with that said, I will entertain a motion on approval of these grants.
Mayor, I move to accept grant E3S3C01D.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any public comment on that?
No, Mayor.
No. Please vote in the affirmative by raising your hand and saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Passes 7-0.
Very good.
Mayor, I move to accept grant E3S3F01D.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor, please raise your hand and say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Passes 7-0.
Very good.
Mayor, I move to accept grant E3S3D01C.
Second.
All in favor, please indicate by saying aye and raising your hand.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Passes 7-0.
Thank you, Dr. Sabata.
Thank you.
Concludes our agenda items today, and I do have a quote here from one of my ancestors' next-door neighbor in Prince Edward County in Virginia. The issue today is the same it has been throughout history, whether man shall be allowed to govern himself or ruled by a small elite. Thomas Jefferson. This meeting is adjourned.